gonna take you on a tour of house on the move. Elements.
Listen, children.
Yes.
I'm gonna tell you about this thing called house music.
XM80.
The Move.
Hey, it's C-Drive. Join me for the next hour as we explore the career of house music visionary Kerri Chandler. We'll chat with Kerri here in our studios, where he just laid down a set in Dance Studio 10, featuring a few cuts off his latest LP, A Basement, A Red Light, and A Feeling, Volume 2 on Madhouse Records. From his signature bass lines to revolutionizing the Jersey sound, we'll discuss and listen to the tracks which brought the rise of house music's most humble superstar,
Kerri Chandler,
on an elemental move.
The truth is, yeah, I became interested as soon as I got to see what my father was doing, and he was DJing. And I don't know, I just always wanted to hang out with him and go to the club with him and stuff like that. And I started warming up for him at the club, and that's where it really took off. And he kind of busted me one day on his turntables. And I always used to hear him come to the house. You know, like, he used to get on his bike. He had, you know, sports cars and all these other things. But he got on his bike one day. And I can kind of hear him, because he always revs these things up. And I didn't hear him coming through the door one day, and he has these turntables, these old A&R turntables, and you had to pick the platter up and change the speed with the belt, and it had like a pitch on the side of it. And I just, you know, I was right in the middle of changing the speed for the belt to go back down to 33. I'm standing on a chair because I couldn't reach that high to get up to the turntables, and he just busts me coming in through the front door. What are you doing? What is this about? What are you on my decks for? And I was just like, well, I'm mixing. And he just looks at me and says, I don't know what you're going to do. What you're going to end up breaking this stuff. You know? And he says, I tell you what, if you know how to mix, I'll bring you to the club on the weekend. But if you don't know how to mix, you know, I'm going to crucify you. I was about 8 years old. And
but what did he really say?
He really said that.
Crucify?
He told me he was going to crucify you. I started mixing in front of him, his mouth dropped, and I was like, just beat mixing everything. And these are like old records, and I'm still getting it off, and he's looking like, oh my God, you know, what's going on here? And that was it. The following weekend, I was in the club with him. They just put me on a crate. I was standing up. They'd hand me records, and I'd start mixing and warming up the place before everything really started jumping off. And my mother, I'd see her walking through the door, and I'd try to hide, you know, hiding under everything. I don't want to go home. It's like, you know, 11:30, 12 o'clock, and they're getting me out of there just when things started picking up, you know. I always hated that. There's the Raleigh Racquet Club. I'll never forget that one in Paradiso. Yeah, that was in New Jersey. That was actually in East Orange. Amazing places.
So how did this bring you to DJing and producing house music?
I always listened to the disco stuff and soulful stuff, and I don't know, I think the first thing that did it for me, I was listening to like Adonis Records and Donnie and all this kind of stuff, and it just kind of caught me, and it just caught me out there one day, and I was just like, oh, okay, then, you know, Farley's stuff, and I was just like, this is pretty interesting. It kind of caught me one day, and I was doing, you know, bits of rap stuff at the time, and, you know, it's kind of in the between the both of them, because when we used to play like house parties, we had to play everything, both of them. A friend of mine doing production, He asked me, he says, well, why don't you think about, you know, doing some house stuff? And it was more like a dare to him. He says, I think you'd be good at it. Maybe you should try some house stuff. And I said, okay, you know, I'm doing rap stuff. I don't see why not. Might as well try it just to mess around and see what happens. And I just did it as I can't really say it was a joke. It's just doing it. And I had no idea, you know, what house was really, really about at the time.
This led to Kerri Chandler's first 12-inch release that came out in 1990 on Atlantic Records. The single was called Super Lover, and it had this mad B-side on it called Get It Off.
I was DJing at a club named America, Club Americas, every weekend. And down the street, there used to be Tony Humphries. And, I don't know, every time I finished up, we finished about maybe 4:30, and I'd walk over to Tony's club, back and forth, and it's just, I dropped him off some of the reels I happened to be bringing with me, because we were always infamous for cutting and slicing reels up, so I brought him the tapes, and he just started playing them on his radio show. But how it all started was, you know, my friend Walsh just asked me to just, you know, make some tracks up and stuff, and Get It Off and Super Lover were, kind of the same thing. Get It Off was like, I had a few problems, and Get It Off was actually Get It Off of My Mind, because my girlfriend at the time had died, and I just had to get it off of my mind, and that's what it was. And it's just me messing around, trying to come up with something. I had no idea of how to actually make house. I was just engineering at the time, you know, still I'm a tech freak and I loved making things like that.
Yeah.
Drink on Me and Get It Off were my very first house tracks.
Also in 1990, under the alias Thule, Kerri put out Drink on Me on Profile Records. I asked him what the deal was with the track.
Drink on Me is even funnier because at Club America, they had these people that walked down to the club. Like, there are, I call two types of people in clubs. One are the powder guys, the powder people. I love those guys because they always put down powder, flip over their heads, and just do everything they want to do. And then there were the drink guys who'd walk sideways with the drinks and the suits and always try to, like, you know, look cool, you know, and try to pull women the whole night with suits on, polyester suits with, you know, whatever ties. And Drink on Me was a call to the bartender to give away free drinks to everyone. So that's what Drink on Me actually is. So anytime that, you know, I'd see like these, you know, suits and ties going to the dance floor, I'd immediately pull a reel out, put Drink on Me on, the red light upstairs would go on, and all of the suit and ties would go back upstairs and let the powder people have fun, and they have their drinks, and that was the end of it.
So come here and have a little.
Perhaps one of the main reasons that Kerri Chandler has remained more an underground legend than a music superstar is due to his many aliases. With well over 112 inch singles, remixes, and albums out, he's recorded under such names as Gate A, Chaos 623, Grandpa, Third Generation, Dreamer G, and Thule. And when collaborating, the vocalist or featured artist is always generously granted top billing. I asked Kerri about his most recognizable handle.
Chaos 623 is just a bad day of the year. Every year I've always noticed something really horrible happens around June. It's either 30 days before June or 30 days after June. I've had pretty much everything that could go wrong on June 23rd or around in it. I had everything from like people died. Like my one year my grandmother died, my cousin died, and my uncle died day after each other on the 23rd, 24th, 25th. Year after, my other grandfather. One year I was being shot at, you know? And I don't look for these things, you know? It just seems to run around the same time. My house caught on fire one year. I lost a lot of records and things. Same thing, it always happens around June 23rd. I had a tax problem, the letter came on June 23rd. You know? I was walking home from the studio one night and I got jumped, like, you know, that morning. Just out of the blue, this guy comes up. And I was thinking to myself that morning, too, wow, I'm actually getting away with it. Nothing's happening. I'm walking home like, da-da-da-da-da, like nothing happened this month. You know, it's just cool. So, but I've noticed, you know, and I got to laugh at it. So I'm kind of like, in a way, turning it around so it's good luck instead of just like this horrible time of year for me.
This off Kerri Chandler's latest album, A Basement, A Red Light, and A Feeling, Volume 2, Isis Hanging on Madhouse Records.
Seven wonders of my universe. But you couldn't understand me. My language was not yours. Yet I loved you. There was a time when time was all I really wanted from you. Maybe because time was what I'd grown accustomed to. Your mysteries enthralled me, so that I couldn't see past the stars that shined in your eyes. And your magical touch could heal me, cure me of any wrong. But you still couldn't understand me, and your language was not my own. Yet still I loved you. And now it seems that time is all we have. When you keep saying that we don't. And I have to wonder, because you see, absence doesn't always make the heart grow fonder.
Ask Kerri about the first release on Shelter Records, an anthem for Club Shelter, which he produced under the alias Gaeta. Club Shelter opened March 1st, 1991 at 6 Hubert Street in New York City with resident DJ Timmy Regisford. And Kerri also mentions DJ Merlin Bob, who was at first a doorman at Tony Humphrey's Club Zanzibar, and later found popularity as a mix DJ on WBLS, a radio station in New York, in late 1985. In 1991, Merlin Bob left BLS to do Shelter with Timmy Regisford. Then in 1992, one of the partners on Club Shelter, Freddie Sannin, began Shelter Records, and the first release was the anthem that Kerri Chandler produced, with vocals from Chris McRae, a pink label with a big Fallout Shelter icon printed on it that he talks about here.
I would play at the Shelter every once in a while with Timmy and Merlin when it first opened, and Merlin came to me and said, why don't you come up with a theme song for the club? And I said, okay, yeah. And he said, just don't make it any huge thing, just a nice, simple four-track style kind of song, something that encompasses the club into the song. So I said, okay, fine, you know, I went home and I just messed around with some things. I got Chris in, Chris sang a bit, and Dee Dee was there, and we just kept messing around with little ideas, and I finally came up with the idea, and I said, okay, cool, since it's the Shelter, I'm going to the Shelter. I brought some of my equipment there, and I mixed it sonically in the Shelter so it would sound correct, like it's for the club, so I'm going to mix the song in the club. It fit perfect. Merlin was cool with everybody, you know, was into the song, and everybody knew the Shelter, because we played it every weekend. And then Freddie comes to me one day, and he says, Kerri, he says, you know, that Shelter song, can I have it for, you know, the label? I want to start a label called Shelter. And I said, you want what? I said, you want the Shelter? I said, I think that's bizarre, man. Who in the world, and I don't know what I was thinking. I said, who in the world is going to play a song about another club in their club? That doesn't make any sense, because everyone would be coming to our club. It doesn't make any sense. He said, just trust me. Let me just, you know, let me put it out. And later on, I was just thinking, 30,000 records later, I'm looking at him like, how did you... You know, it's like, you're sick, man. I said, I don't know how. And I still, the funny thing is, even though I may have a couple, every time I see something like that, like either that or track one, I always pick up another copy. Even though I did it. It's just like, I know I might have like two or three at the house. I end up picking another one up for some odd reason. And all my friends keep doing the same thing. Anytime I say, oh, Shelter, I need another one. And I know I got too many at the house already.
You? Did you see you were spinning at the Shelter?
Like the nightclub, the Shelter label was a deep house sensation, and both continue to remain successful today. The fourth release on Shelter Records was from Kerri also. Called the Atmosphere EP, it contained another house anthem that soon began to be known simply as Track 1.
Oh, Track 1. Yeah, Track 1 is always... That's funny how that even came about. What happened was my friend Jerome, sitting there again, he wanted to actually just come up with this thing. It was supposed to be like this small project in Japan, like a, you know, white label, boot label, you know, bootleg kind of thing. And he just wanted a 4-track EP. And they said, just come up with something pretty quick and just make it as quick as you can, and, you know, whatever, I need it today. And I'm in for us making tracks like that because the system is just on and I know everything really well. And I came up with that entire EP in less than a day. And I gave it to Jerome, and he called each track, like, it was supposed to be like a bootleg for Madhouse. Like, track one was literally called 007. The other one was something else. There's actually still some booze floating around from Japan of the same, the original way it was before it got to Shelter Records. To me, it was just like a quick thing. It was originally supposed to be for Sable Jeffries. She was supposed to put vocals on it when I thought of it conceptually, because I was still doing stuff for Atlantic at the time. And I don't know, I just said, here, I'll just put it together. It took me a couple minutes to put, I have this idea I was going to use for Sable. I'll just put it here and just, you know, give it to you, an SCP thing, and da da da. And the rest of it just took like that to make. Next thing I know, it just seems to be everyone, yeah, Track 1. I'm like, Track 1? What is Track 1? Because I'd never even seen the label when it all came together.
a monumental house track, Inspiration, teamed Kerri Chandler up with Vocal House's rising star Arnold Jarvis. Sankey, the man behind Freetown Records, had released music from Jarvis before on Freetown's sixth release called It Must Have Been Love, and he introduced the two. He released Inspiration in 1994 with a double pack of remixes to be released on Freetown several months later. When I asked Kerri about Inspiration, he mentions a sad time for house music, when Freetown Sankey and John Robinson, a legendary DJ who brought real house music to New York City's airwaves on WBLS, died in a car accident. But here's the story behind one of the all-time vocal house anthems, Inspiration.
Inspiration was same thing again. I had this place that everything that night was perfect. I met Sankey, which was another friend of mine who actually died in a car accident with John Robinson, of all people. Who owned Freetown. And he brought Arnold to me. I always, you know, I knew Arnold's stuff, but I never met Arnold. And when he brought him in, you know, he said, you know, Kerri, I want you to do an album, but I want you to put Arnold on the album. And me and Arnold hit it off instantly, like, as soon as we started talking. And the place was huge that I had. It looked like a Ministry of Sound, and I had it wired up like a club. But it was the studio, and I had, like, the studio stuff in the middle of the room. And I just put some drums on, and Arnold was there, like, yeah. And I turned the lights on, because that light had, like, flash tubes and strobes and mirrored balls and everything else up in there. So he's running around with the cordless mic in the place, and there's drums going. And I'm playing, you know, keys and trying to think of stuff. And he says, I have an idea. I have this friend in the hospital who's, he has cancer, but, you know, he's always been an inspiration because he's still excited to, you know, be alive, and he's happy, and, you know, he hasn't got a care in the world. So he wrote down about maybe four words, and we just went over it once and just practiced it. And I played, and I said, okay, cool, let me go in here and sequence this thing, you know, and then I'll get you set up. He says, you know what? He says, I like the way you were playing that. Can you just play that instead of, you know, can we play it together? Can I just sing and you play? I said, I've never recorded anything like that, so I guess, yeah, I guess you can try that. So, you know, I put down basic drums and a bass line, and I said, okay, fine, I'm going to play the piano, and you can just do it. We'll take it like that. Inspiration was literally taken in, like, one take. That was it. He sang. I played over top of it. It went on for maybe 18 minutes. That was it. We just took one long take. And that's Inspiration. He was really inspired, and I was like, just happy to play with, you know, Arnold. Like, you know, I was just like, cool, this is nice. And now it is. It took us all of maybe half hour.
Oh, you're an inspiration to me. Let's celebrate life. Life has just begun for me. You're an inspiration. Let's celebrate life. Just begun. Rejoice for life. Inspiration to me. Beautiful, beautiful creation of life. You're a pillar to me.
being as much a DJ as a producer, I asked Kerri who his favorite DJs were.
I'm going to be very biased and say that between Joe Clasell and Francois, and to me, that's just like, you know, they just go for heartfelt music and it's timeless the way they play. And, you know, Jerome, Sidney, same thing. He's always taking risks. And DJ Deep, he's always taking risks. It's just, you know, and these are very close friends of mine. I really, really admire what they do. When they play, it's like I feel it, and I love when DJs can do that.
Joe Clasell and Francois Kevorkian are DJ legends who, until just last July 2002, played weekly together with Danny Cribbit at a Sunday afternoon party in New York City called Body and Soul. Joe Clasell was born and raised in New York City, has been one of the owners of house music record shop Dance Tracks in New York, and in 1995 began a deep Afrocentric house label Spiritual Life, which remains unparalleled today. Jerome Sydenham is another very close friend of Kerri's who runs and owns Ibadan Records. They first met when Kerri Chandler's professional recording career was just in its infancy, and Jerome was working A&R at Atlantic Records at the time, home to Kerri's first couple singles. Kerri then told me about one of his largest musical influences.
If it wasn't for Tony Humphries, I wouldn't be sitting here in front of you. Seriously. He gave me so many breaks and taught me the ropes. I mean, I have nothing else to say but thank you to Tony. That is, to me, my influence from where I started, where I began, and I learned so much from him. You know, even with the turntables. And I wish he could do more of it. He used to play on Thorns, and that's where I started collecting turntables, because it was incredible to me to see somebody play on something different than 1200s or some techniques thing. He actually played on Thorns and played with them well. You know, those things don't go past like plus two, but he'd ride disco records like it wasn't nothing. And these are turntables, you can't go backwards. You have to touch them, feather light. Anything you do wrong with those things, you'll know, you'll hear it instantly. But the way he played with those things in Zanzibar were amazing. Tony's a master at what he does. He's so incredible at his craft, and it's just, even me and Jerome, we said the same thing. Jerome came up with a term. He calls it disco heaven, and he'd only get that like listening to Tony in Zanzibar. And he said, "You feel that? That's disco heaven. That's Tony Humphries."
Tony Humphries began his DJ career in 1975 and defined what has been coined as the Jersey sound at Zanzibar, which was right down the street from Kerri Chandler's residency, Club America. Tony's still DJing worldwide on XM Satellite Radio's Magic Sessions and running Yellow Orange Records back in his hometown of East Orange.
Elemental Move.
This is Kerri Chandler, and you're listening to The Future Unfiltered. On XM80, The Move.
A Basement, A Red Light, and A Feeling, Volume 2. Just been released on Kerri Chandler's own Madhouse Records. Run out to the shops, get this record, because it's one of the finest house music releases in a while now, with brand new collaborations with Kerri Chandler and folks like Isis, Chris McRae, Arnold Jarvis, and even a track called Vibrations from Roy Ayers. Roy Ayers is known as the godfather of acid jazz and is best known for his hit in 1976 entitled Everybody Loves the Sunshine.
My life in the sunshine. Everybody loves the sunshine.
Sunshine. From this point on, Ayers began to move closer to the dance floor, releasing disco records like Can You See Me, Running Away, and Sweet Tears. Roy Ayers never stayed too far from his dance floor roots, doing a remake of Sweet Tears in 1996 for Masters at Work's New York and Soul project, as well as releasing house tracks with Scott Grooves, Ferry Ultra, Jay Cartel, and now collaboration with Kerri Chandler, which Kerri's father co-produced. The track's called Vibrations, and you can find it on Madhouse Records.
I got to work with someone I really admire and look up to. He came in, he was just great. He felt like he was an uncle, like a long-lost uncle who just came in. And even when the session was over, he was so funny. He was like the silliest, coolest guy. Because my dad came up and they were talking like old buddies and stuff. So it was just interesting. It's really, really nice. And I can't wait to do it again.
Vibrations.
vibrations, good vibrations. Good vibrations, good vibrations, good vibrations. Good vibrations, good vibrations, good vibrations. Good vibrations, good vibrations, good vibrations.
I asked Kerri if there was a specific track that he had the best time producing or he would consider a favorite, and he told me about a song that he wrote for his daughter, also named Kerri, which appeared on a Chicago-based label, Large Records. Kerri's done quite a bit of work for Large, like the Raw Groove series and Digital Soul series, and this song appeared on Kerri's Digital Soul Volume 4.
There's a track I did for my daughter, Kerri, and it's a bit heartfelt for me. It's very personal. It's almost like a letter in third person, explaining, you know, to my daughter how much I care about her, and just a silly day, like a Saturday that, you know, we might hang out and stuff. It's kind of talking to her. The reason I did is because she has no idea what I do at all. She hasn't got a clue. She just thinks daddy's smart so he doesn't have to do anything or something. And that's how she looks at me. And I'm like, okay. You know, and she explained it to me one day, and I thought it was the silliest thing I ever did. She says, yo, my mommy does everything. She cleans the house, she does this, she does that. But daddy, he's just smart. He just does nothing. He just sits there. And I'm like, okay, well, I'm a producer. Don't you understand what that is? He says, no, you just play the piano or something. And I'm just like, no, but, you know, take a look around you. This is what I do. I do records, you know, I show magazines and stuff. And she just looks at it like, you know, okay. What's this mean? It's just another book, you know. So you're in a book? Yeah, okay. And she just looks at me that way, and she's very curious. But the thing is, I always thought if something ever happened to me, because I travel a lot, I fly almost out of, in and out of everywhere, like every weekend. And I just wanted to leave her a mark saying, you know, just how much I cared about her and I wanted her to know in my own way. And music to me has always been an outlet, because I'm basically a really shy person. But for me, music is more, you know, an outlet. More of my voice than actually my voice. You can tell and how my day is gone with the songs I make. And that's really it. It's just my songs to me when I produce something. It's actually my life. It really is. And you can hear what happened. Everything's an influence. A song for my daughter, that's what it's called. It's on Digital Soul 4. It's on Large.
This has been an elemental episode of The Move with guest Kerri Chandler. Check out Kerri's new record or CD, A Basement, Red Light, and A Feeling Volume 2 on Madhouse Records. Many thanks to Rob Wonderman of King Street Records, James at DJ Hut Record Store in Washington, D.C., Jeff Craven and Talo at Large Records, Taha of T-Coli Productions, The Internet, and two Boeing 702 satellites, and of course, Kerri Chandler. Stay close to The Move to hear Kerri lay down an hour set recorded live here at XM Satellite Radio's Dance Studio 10. I'm C-Drive. Thanks for joining me. Peace.
XM to me is the next step because it's incredible to me. Anything having to do with technology and something like this, to have the same radio station with me throughout the country to me is a blessing because I hate, right now, I can't stand the way radio is. My name is Kerri Chandler, and to me, House. And now you've probably heard a million times before, it's more a feeling. The state of the industry is as complex as it is. You can't destroy it, it is underground music, and that's what it is. If it goes overhead, then great. But it always seems to me a cycle, a 10-year cycle. It's just a beautiful thing with people coming back and listening to where the roots are. It's encompassing so many wondrous styles and versions. I mean, there's Brazilian, there's jazz, there's just straight tech, there's so much to it. And it's just amazing how people still can grasp a hold of it, no matter where I go. You know, a lot of people can't understand rap stuff where I go. A lot of people can't understand, you know, certain types of music. I've never heard anyone that didn't like house music where I went to. If, even in places where they've done like tech house and wild things like that. I played in some club, it was a German techno club, and it had like the odd floor, of course. And I played and I got the entire upstairs to downstairs somehow, just playing very tricky. And this guy runs up to me and he asks, so what is this new kind of techno you're playing? And I was just like, this is house. This is house music, original gospel style house music. And he was so happy to hear it. And to me, that just means a lot. If I can just flip over one person to introduce them to house music, to me, that's the world, you know. And then to play some of these songs that are older than the crowd that I'm playing for, and they come up and ask me, what is that? And I'm like, this is stuff, you know, I grew up. This is what I, you know, influenced me when I heard it. And there's one song I play every time, and it catches, this one always catches me out. I can always tell what kind of night I'm gonna have depending on how people react to this one song. And it's Bohanna, Let's Start the Dance. And the reason I play it is because when I was growing up, I remember this song being on, and my Uncle Arnold and my dad, they're both DJs, and they threw this huge party at a civic center, and the speaker caught fire when that song was on. And I thought that was the coolest thing I've ever seen. They're wheeling out a car, trying to blow it out with a fire extinguisher. And I'm like, that's bad. That is dope. That's a bad song. I don't care what I gotta do. I'm bringing that song with me everywhere. And I literally have like maybe 6-7 copies of that one song. And every time I play it, either somewhere in the breakdown in the choruses, I can tell what the night's gonna be like, depending on how high people's hands are up in the air. And to me, that's amazing. That song is timeless, the way that song is done. And that to me is house. And that's where house roots are.
Yeah.
Start the revolution.
XM 80.